My name is Rob Entz, and on behalf of the Bateman Horne Center, I'm very, very happy to welcome you here tonight. We have a very special guest who is going to be our speaker, and one whose name will be very, very familiar to you. I'm not going to spend a lot of time telling you about the Bateman Horne Center because I think all of you have followed the history and you know about where it started. You know about Dr. Cindy Bateman and how we got to this place. I want to just share with you a couple of thoughts about how I became connected with the organization and why I really believe in the future and what holds promise for solutions in some very difficult and challenging illness for individuals and families. Again, my name is Rob Entz, and I recently became the executive director of the Bateman Horne Center. And I met Cindy probably about 6 to 8 months ago. I've had the privilege of getting to know some of the members of her family, a very, very dedicated legacy of providers and medical care. And many of you know the story of what really channeled her work from being an internal medicine specialist to focusing on this disease as a result of things that happened with her sister. But I have to tell you that what really attracted me was that this is an organization that is on the cutting edge of medical science. And with Dr. Bateman's commitment, her passion, her personal experience, her ability to teach and influence others, to inspire a community to rally around what must be done in order for us to flesh out not only appropriate diagnoses, but treatment for ME/CFS. And I immediately warmed to the challenge. I embrace what work lies ahead. And my heart goes out to all of those of you who deal with this in your daily lives. And there is a very, very big commitment on behalf of the board and others who work at the clinic and the research center to make a difference of this particular condition in the future. But we owe our vision and we owe our loyalty to Dr. Bateman for her vision and for her example and leadership. So this time I want to turn it over to Dr. Cindy Bateman. And for the next hour or so, we'll have an interactive conversation and some lecture and time for some questions and answer. I just wanted to also welcome those who are joining us via live streaming and hope that you will enjoy this session as much as I hope to. Thank you. Cindy.
I want you to know I'm wearing my wild socks. So I don't know if everyone knows, but I vowed in January that I was going to wear wild socks until we had good or better or improved usable biomarkers for making diagnoses. So I'm actually going to tell you that hopefully some of the things I'm going to share today are as good as a biomarker. So we'll see how that goes. I also want to say that no talk can apply to all patients. So I'm going to present some very general information that I've learned through my experience with many, many patients, but the individual advice may not apply entirely to every person with these illnesses. I'm going to put a little more focus on ME/CFS than fibro today, although they're all very good general principles. And I would also say that these comments may not apply to the most severely ill patients who fall in really a different category of the way, of the kind of support and care they need. So about 30 years ago, many, many patients, their house got picked up by a tornado and they got taken far from home and fell down in a strange land. And honestly, about the same time, I was up in a balloon and got, you know, caught in the breeze and ended up falling down in a strange land also. And I've been trying to think about what to talk about today, but it took me, I spent hours and hours and hours trying to think about how to communicate the many things going on right now in the field and the things we have in store and what we can do across many avenues. So I've tried to boil it down, but the important thing I wanted to start out with is this is a little overwhelming sometimes what we're trying to do, and it's exhausting. And I finished a long consultation with a patient who'd flown in, and he sat back in his chair at the end and he said, "You know what? You remind me of the Wizard of Oz." And what he meant was, you know, the pulling back of that curtain and seeing that, you know, I'm just little old me on the other side of that curtain. And even in this, even in the movie, he's doing what he thinks needs to be done. You know, everybody puts him higher and higher on a pedestal and has higher and higher expectations. So what I wanted to talk about today is a little bit more about that. We really want, we all want someone to rescue us. We want the all-powerful wizard or the good witch to give us the things we've been longing for. And what I want to say today is I really believe we have the answers, many of them already. Some of them are within us, and some of them are within those people back in Kansas. But I also believe there's no place like home. And what I mean by that is I think we all need to go back to Kansas. And I believe things are different now, and that we need to mainstream with science and clinical medicine in order to take on the enormity of what we have ahead. And it's time to go back to Kansas. And that may seem a little scary because most of us got blown away from Kansas and it's been a really hard 30 years. So I want to start with what I, with the, just a brief slide. These are the clinical criteria that were recommended after the Institute of Medicine report. These are the first published evidence-based clinical criteria, and the whole purpose of them is for doctors to do a better job of making a diagnosis. That's what they're for. So we tried to, in this evidence-based review, using information from many studies, patients, pick out the most common, most important features of the illness and put them in as core value, core symptoms. That doesn't mean these are the only symptoms, but the core criteria, and that means all of these have to be there, or you know, they have to have a really good reason to not have them there, and they have to all be there together. Impaired function, illness relapse after activity, and refreshing sleep, cognitive impairment, or the static intolerance. And they have to be present most of the time, or very reliably, intermittently, and they have to be moderate to severe. Honestly, I've been a clinician for 30 years, and I think these criteria are going to help us, help doctors pick out people who have this kind of illness. And there are other common features of illness, and I'm going to touch on a couple of them. But what I want to share with you is what I call a time-tested approach to supportive care and to self-management. And at the Bateman Horne Center right now, we have a threefold thrust of our mission. One is to support and advance research. And we're doing that by helping patients get engaged in research and trying to leverage that and bring a lot of interested researchers to our patient samples so that we can really get a lot more research going in a shorter time. But we also, I really think the even more critical problem is we don't have doctors who understand how to, not only how to make the diagnosis, but what to do about it. And I feel a great responsibility as an internist and a clinician to find a way to pass that on. But it also needs to be given, you all, patients who have this illness need to be more empowered. So I'm going to go through the things that over 30 years patients have taught me really make a difference in their care. And these are the kind of things that we do before we have the magic bullet or before we understand the underlying physiology. And doing these things is going to put you in a position to be more prepared to engage in research or to maybe to respond to treatment as they come forward. So essentially, we're going to talk about pacing, and then I'm going to pick some of these major aspects of illness, touch on them, sleep, orthostatic intolerance, pain, mental health, fitness. We're not going to talk about all of them, but I'm going to talk about the ones I think we've brushed over the most and really missed an opportunity to diagnose and act on these symptoms, and I think we can do it right now with a little bit more information. I put in three slides that I don't want to go through, but you remember point one was to diagnose everything you can find and treat it, right, in that hierarchy. And so I put three slides in here of what I would tell physicians who are taking on a patient about how they might do that differential diagnosis. And this is a slide I used in another talk, but fatigue can come from so many avenues. If you think about it, on the left of the screen are all the medical illnesses, on the right are all the mental health illnesses, up above are things we don't often think about, but we kind of know they cause fatigue, and then age-related fatigue. But the important thing to remember is you can have any of these things superimposed or alongside an illness like fibromyalgia or ME/CFS. There's no reason to think that you can't develop a grief response or become more fatigued from poor sleep. So I think kind of thinking about all these many causes of fatigue is something every patient has to do themselves and also with their primary care providers in the beginning and on an ongoing basis. I also made a brief list of some of the things that might get overlooked and that's maybe not a bad idea to just, if you've kind of gone down that path with doctors, you can say, you know, what about this? Have I had a test for this? And your doctors know how to do those things. And if they don't, they can help you, direct you to someone who does. So let's come back to the major presenting symptoms as there are features of the illness as they're discussed in the Institute of Medicine report. So number one and number two of the required core symptoms for a clinical diagnosis of ME/CFS are, we've tried to walk around that term fatigue. It's not exactly fatigue, but it's fatigue or limited stamina having a very small envelope or a low threshold for relapse. So it's huge. It's not the same as fatigue, right? So this is a concept that needs to be communicated very carefully, and it's physical, cognitive, orthostatic, sensory, many aspects to the fatigue ability, if that makes sense. Post-exertional malaise, or PEM, we've borrowed that term from one of the old case definitions, but the meaning of it is the consequence of doing more than the envelope allows. These are the flip side of the same thing, right? One is how much you can do, and the second is what happens to you if you go past that. And it's really, for the most part, illness relapse. Recognizing those two things is really important for self-management. It's also almost impossible for doctors to understand. They're just not taught to ask the questions in the right way. So we need to teach them to do that, but you also need to learn to communicate that. And I wanted to talk just briefly about some of the reasons that I feel so committed to this idea of a low threshold and then post-exertional consequences. And some of it comes from papers with great researchers right here in Salt Lake. And these are two of the published papers. One of them was in the Journal of Pain. And these are our colleagues, Alan and Kathy Light, and their team. When I told Alan Light that there was something different about patients, not, you know, that some of them just, we couldn't exercise. And that's a guideline for fibromyalgia. And I said, this group of people can't exercise. When they do, they get sicker. And he said, well, we should be able to measure that. And it turned out that was a big area of expertise in the field. So we designed, I chose the patients to go into this pilot study. And I picked patients I knew very well. I knew what they had, and I knew what happened to them when they tried to go outside their envelope. And what when we did this in controls, I'll show you, first of all, we measured all those things on the right. Don't want to take too much time about it, but this is something your gene is making to respond to the stress of the exercise. So we asked people to get on a bike for 20 minutes and just pedal for 20 minutes. We measured everything before and right after the exercise. We also measured it. We drew their blood that night, the following morning, and 2 days later. So we have multiple blood draws on every patient that were, you know, before and then on several occasions after they did the exercise. And that's what these columns are here. Baseline, 30 minutes, 8 hours, 24 and 48 hours. And then you can see about how much the expression of those proteins coming off the DNA increased because of the exercise. These are the normal people. And these are the people that I picked that went in. And you can see that immediately following exercise, there was a response, a physiologic response to the stressor, and it didn't go away. We had separate blood draws for 48 hours, and every single blood draw showed a big elevation of the of those receptors about sensation to the brain, fatigue, pain, your autonomic nervous system and your inflammatory system reacting to the exercise stressor. That's what happens. So we ask those people to go outside their envelope, and then we wanted to see if we could measure what post-exertional malaise like might look like, in at least with this kind of a measure. This was a study done in MS patients, and then there was also a study done in people after high-intensity exercise. But you can see that so far, there is nothing like what happens to these patients after they overextend themselves with moderate cardiovascular exercise for 20 minutes. And just to give you some contrast, individually the responses were quite different. But you can see this is one person, and he, with a zero at baseline after the exercise, for the next three blood draws, two of those markers hit the top of the graph. You see that? And those have to do with the autonomic nervous system. Well, and he carries a lot of diagnoses, he meets a lot of criteria, he's pretty sick. Well, get this, here's another person, a younger person, and his went exactly the opposite direction. It's hard, these are different blood draws, right? Developed at different times. There's no mistaking the fact that these are really different. So we saw an array of responses to exercise, but there's still a response to exercise, and they're, even to this date, we're having a hard time explaining all this, replicating these studies because of the broad array of patients we have and also how it progresses over time and all kinds of variation. But there's no question that these people have a threshold, and if they go over it, there are some consequences. So this particular, these two really important symptoms, we don't really have a test for. It's really up to you. You need to communicate it clearly, those of you who are ill, to everyone around you, your doctors, your family, and everybody can help you make adjustments. And it's really up to you to self-manage. I'm going to talk more about pacing. There are studies using tilt table tests, but it's really not practical for people to do two tilt. Tilt table on there. What I meant was cardiopulmonary exercise testing. I don't know what I was thinking when I wrote that slide. But if you do cardiopulmonary exercise tests on one day and on the second day, you can see that people are more ill and unable to replicate the same energy production on day two. But those tests can cause a lot of symptoms and relapse, and are hard to get, and it really doesn't tell you what to do, right, about it in treatment. So the first tool I want to pass on in this talk is that the most important intervention right now is understanding how to pace. And I'm going to talk to you a little bit more about what pacing means. So if you're given, let's use money, because we all like money. If you're given a dollar of energy a day, and $1 is about 4 hours. So if that's what you get. Normal people, get the whole day, but you're just gonna get that 4 hours of energy. How do you spend it? You can either just go till you drop and you have to stop, whether it's one day or the second day or the third day. You can split it up, or you can do 4 hours in the morning and then relax. You can do 2 hours in the morning, 2 hours in the afternoon. You can do 1 hour, those separate times. And you can also do 20 minutes out of each hour. So that's what pacing is, right? It's do a little, rest a little, do a little, rest a little. And I think the most efficient pacing is, the lower you go on that list is probably the way to have the fewest symptoms. Now, that's not really compatible with life, but the more you can do that, the better. So pacing is limiting activity to the $1 most of the time. It's activity spread out through the day. It's engaging in recovery behaviors when you're not active. So that might be resting, putting your feet up, hydrating, whatever it is you need to do. And you really need to avoid debt. And debt means that you just ignore the fact that you only have a dollar and you spend $5 in energy that day. Well, what happens is if you go into debt, you will eventually become very ill. So, and it depends, right, on how much you go over and how sick you are. But that you real pacing is an awareness that when debt accrues, it should be paid off as soon as you can. So if you got to do something big that breaks the rule, then you should be resting this, the next day to kind of come back to baseline. So it's really dynamic, but it's very, very important. And it's being in a preventive, not a rescue mode. And I really believe that the less time you spend in debt or in post-exertional malaise, the more likely you are to have a, to get to improve and have a better prognosis for recovery. But most important, the symptom burden comes down and people suffer less from the horrible symptoms. So it reduces the frequency and severity and improves the prognosis. So your goal is to do about the amount of activity that doesn't induce post-exertional malaise. And the goal is feeling back to baseline after a good night of sleep. And if you create post-exertional malaise or debt, then you should sort of just rest until it resolves. You can also save up. But this concept is important. You really need to develop a heightened sense of awareness about where that threshold is, and it's sometimes a moving target, and the consequences of pushing beyond it. And you really need not to be afraid, but to be in charge. So one of the things that happens with pacing is sometimes people are afraid to do anything, and their activity level gets less and less until their world is very small. And the other thing that happens is people just charge forward until their symptoms are so high that they're put down. One of the ways to begin monitoring your activity are with self-monitoring devices. And I've just, because I own a Fitbit HR and a Fitbit Blaze, I'm going to talk about them because I have the most understanding of those particular ones. I don't really care which kind you like, but there's many ways to use activity monitors to do pacing. So that picture on the left, those bars represent the amount of activity each day for a week. That's pacing. The one on the right, that's not pacing, right? Big high activity and then unable to do very much activity. So you can use your readout and you can look at it for a day, a week, a month, 3 months, and see not only if you're like up and down, but also if your ability to do more goes up or slowly goes down. So I'm going to leave pacing because I think we understand about it, but it is important because people without the illness don't understand it very well, and it's hard to communicate. So next I want to talk about the third core criteria listed in the clinical, in the IOM case definition, or sorry, the clinical case definition. So we know that this illness, and also fibromyalgia, so this is a real common ground with fibromyalgia, that sleep disturbances are very common. Discussion of sleep is included in all of the case definitions, and in one study I'll show you, 90% of the people asked about sleep with these illnesses said they had problems with sleep. It's abnormal in quality, and it's abnormal in duration and timing. This is from one big study where they looked at people with well-defined illness of ME/CFS, and they asked, you can't really see the questions, I'll read them to you, but they asked them across the board about, you know, do you experience this? And the green are the answers from the ME/CFS patients, and the red are the answers from the control, healthy control cases. And this is when they were asked if the symptoms were moderate in severity and occurred more than half the time. And it was unrefreshing sleep. That's the one that's 92%. Problems falling asleep, need to nap daily, problems staying asleep, waking up early, or sleeping all day, awake all night, upside down. And you can see that it's a spread, but that's why the term unrefreshing sleep is used, because it's sort of a way to lump everyone under one umbrella. It's the most consistently reported symptom, and there's research that supports that ME/CF patients spend more time in bed and have less quality sleep. It's kind of sad, huh? And this was a study of 300 people in a Dutch study, and these are people who'd had sleep studies, and everybody who had sleep apnea or restless legs or some other kind of a primary sleep disorder were excluded, so they looked purely at the sleep of people with this illness, and it split into four groups. I like to start from the bottom. So the group on the bottom was people with reduced sleep and less REM. The comments on the side are mine. I'm like, yep, that's the people with insomnia. The next group is the people who woke up or had arousals many, many times an hour. Those are people with light sleep or disrupted sleep. Then there are people with reduced REM sleep, and many times that's from medications. And the top one is more sleep and lots of REM, and that's a lot of times that's catch-up sleep. So when you've had very poor sleep and you've had insomnia, then you end up sleeping a long time, having vivid dreams. And we don't really know, but we can say the sleep is really abnormal in patients with ME/CF, CFS, above and beyond. So how do we observe and monitor sleep? Well, the traditional way has been polysomnography. That's a sleep study in the sleep lab. The problem with that, it's very expensive. Insurance isn't usually going to pay for more than one, unless they have to do some follow-up study. And the other is that there's a lot of sleep lab artifact. That means people who go to sleep lab don't sleep very well. They're all wired up and people are staring at them, and so they kind of toss and turn, and there's much more light sleep and movement, and that makes it difficult to look for subtle changes in sleep. There are new studies called home sleep studies. They're not fully accepted, but they're able to measure quite a bit about obstruction, and it's minus the EEG leads. They can do it at home. And then the other option is overnight pulse oximetry, where you just measure your oxygen. But that really only picks up people with the very worst problems with primary sleep disorders. So it doesn't help us very much. But you should be monitoring your own sleep. Every person now has the ability to monitor sleep, and one of it is with these devices. So I'm going to show you a little bit. This is my Fitbit report, and you can see on the first night, I slept 8 hours and 31 minutes. That doesn't happen very often. And the blue is the sleep, and the light blue is times when I was restless, and then the red is times when I was actually awake. You can change the threshold on this, but you can see. And then there was another night I just put down below where I slept less time, but I got up once in the night, but it really, you know, I was pretty good those nights. Well, that's what a monitor can do. That's like a Fitbit. You can look at your sleep, and you can look on the left. You can look at your sleep. Now the bars are small, and you can see separate weeks to see on each day how many hours I slept and how many disruptions there were. You can see that little short one is where I took a nap. But I want you to look on the right side of the screen. This is one of my patients. She's not 30. She's probably 28 years old, 26, 28 years old. And she was telling me, I can't sleep. I have problems sleeping. And she says, I said, well, you know, record it on your Fitbit and bring it in for me. And look at her sleep. Let me show you up closer. She doesn't get very many hours of sleep, and she's probably not asleep, right? Those are all motion artifact and, you know, thrashing and semi-waking up all night, and she probably didn't sleep very well. And she has sleep apnea, but this is on treatment. So she's wearing her CPAP, she's doing everything she could, and there's, of course, this has to be playing a role in how she's feeling. So this is something you can do to monitor and understand your sleep, even if it's not perfect. So Fitbits are these kind of monitoring devices, record the hours of sleep or what approximates sleep, and it will record the number of disruptions. I'm not very good at identifying what's causing those disruptions, and they're not very good at recording the quality of the sleep. This is what happened. This is the kind of data you can get from polysomnography. These are two examples of what happens over sleep. I like the one with the color on it because it's a little easier to see from a distance. But at the beginning of the graph, you're awake, and then you gradually get down into deep sleep where the blue is. Can you see that? And then you kind of come up out of, and you go into REM sleep, which is the red, and then you go back down into deep sleep, then you come back into REM. And there's a pattern of deep sleep early in the night interspersed with REM sleep, and then you kind of gradually come up until you wake up in the morning. And the one below is one taken actually from polysomnography. So the black are the REM sleep, and the lowest ones are deep sleep, and you just need a little bit of everything. You're supposed to cycle through these areas. This is a really good example on the left. This is one night. This is a person in the sleep lab. The one on the left is when they're wearing their CPAP, and the one on the right is when they take the CPAP off. You see what happens? No more deep sleep, frequent awakenings, and it's all light sleep, little bit of REM sleep in there, and awakeness, and no deep sleep. That's why we try to treat people with CPAP who have sleep apnea. That's our goal. So if you've had polysomnography, you can look at your hypnogram because it's on almost all the reports. But the problem is it represents only that one night when you probably weren't sleeping very well. So it would be nice if we could record sleep all the time, right? But that would be prohibitively expensive. Well, maybe not. And I don't know if you know about the research we're engaging in, but this is the Oura Ring. And I just pulled some things off their website to show you a little bit about what it is. This is being developed in Finland. And this Oura Ring is like a little computer, has its sensors and wireless, and it's got a very good battery, and it senses many aspects of your physiology while you wear it 24/7. And it reports on activity, sleep, and readiness. But I just want to talk about sleep right now. This is my readout from the Oura Ring. But look in the middle there. I'm going to make it bigger. What does that look like? It's kind of like a hypnogram, right? And they have technology that approximates. They say it matches pretty well in healthy people with whether or not you get into deep sleep. So if you look at my hypnogram, I started out in light sleep, and then I woke up, see the gray, and then light sleep, and then I went straight into REM sleep. Light sleep, REM, light, REM, and then I finally got into a few minutes of deep sleep at 2 in the morning. See what I'm saying? So you can read your hypnogram using something, and this costs like $300. You could get 30, 60, 90 measures of sleep. You could measure your sleep every time you change your medicines. You could measure sleep every time you drink too much caffeine. You could learn a lot about how to help your sleep. This one I love because this is when I had restless legs. So I went to bed, got into light sleep, woke up, a little bit of REM, woke up, light sleep, woke up, light sleep, woke up, and finally I got up and took something from my restless legs, boom, down into deep sleep. So you can learn about your sleep simply by doing self-monitoring. Now these, I'm not asking you to buy one, but I think this is the beginning of what might be important. They are available. But what we're doing is a pilot study of people with this illness wearing the ring to see if we can, what we can learn about sleep. But what we're learning is it doesn't even read people with the illness the same way. It's wacky. And I think it's because our patients have altered blood flow and altered hormones and altered temperatures and things, but we're still going to be able to learn something about it. So the second tool I want to leave you with today is unrefreshing sleep is abnormal, and you need to investigate your sleep and make your sleep better. Use every healthy method possible to achieve the most restorative sleep. Develop skills in relaxation. Understand medications. And it's really up to you to learn about and implement good sleep hygiene. That is something no one can do for you. And that's, you can look that up on the internet. That's a term that means your behaviors around bedtime. Do you stay up too late? Do you leave the radio on? Do you, you know, eat food in bed? Do you, what are you doing that's really kind of tearing apart your sleep cycles? And you ought to reduce everything that's disrupting sleep, and any treatment should be aimed at what's bothering your sleep, if possible. And don't give up on it, because veterans of managing their illness will tell you that finding the right way to manage sleep is going to be one of the most important interventions next to pacing. And the closer you get to it, the more it's going to help all the other symptoms, the fatigue, cognition, pain, and mood. And I can't talk a whole talk about sleep, but there are, I did give a talk that was recorded on the Solve CFS website, and about and went through quite a bit about sleep hygiene and about medications that might be used. And there are others. Dr. Suzanne Vernon gave a talk and talked a lot about the Oura Ring. And there's also a good talk by Dr. Lee Smith on our YouTube site about how to calm central sensitivity that impacts sleep. Number three is we've missed a great opportunity for 20 years to learn about and intervene with orthostatic intolerance. So orthostatic intolerance means that when you go from lying to standing, your blood pressure and your heart rate may have an abnormal response. And it's measurable and it's treatable. We didn't start doing this kind of measurement until January of this year. Doctors tend to do a 1 minute test where they have you lie down, take your blood pressure and pulse, and at best wait 1 minute, sometimes 3 minutes. Well, the tilt table test is the gold standard, right? But honestly, it's hard to get a tilt table test. And it's not standardized, people do it in different ways, and so using the outcome, the data hasn't been very helpful. So what we adopted, and this is thanks to Dr. Ben Nadelson, who was part of the multi-site study for the Centers for Disease Control with us, he insisted that we all use the same test to measure orthostatic intolerance. So we started using it, and it honestly, my eyes were opened, and I regretted that we hadn't been doing it for the last 20 years. This is a test you can actually do yourself with some help, and I'm going to tell you about it. And then you can use a heart rate tracking device to understand what's going on with your heart rate, because it not only reflects your exercise, but it also may reflect what's going on with your orthostatic intolerance. So I don't know how well you can see this, but this is I want to tell you how this is called the 10-minute NASA lean test. That's NASA, like the space place, and they study what happens when people have been in space a long time. It alters their circulation. So to do this test, you lie down on the bed, get very relaxed, and you take a blood pressure and a pulse. We do it 2 times. Supine means lying down, if you're not familiar with that term. So this is a real person, and I actually honestly hadn't thought about doing, this is one of my patients, and we've been dealing with a bunch of other issues, and she just wasn't doing well, and I thought, we should do this test, right, and see if you have orthostatic intolerance. Honestly, she didn't look like someone who might. So the NASA lean test is a little bit special. You don't just stand up, but you stand next to a wall, about 6 inches away from a wall, and you just lean back so that your shoulder blades are touching the wall. That kind of gives you a little balance, and it keeps you from moving your legs around, because when you move, it alters the test. So you really should just relax, not talk, just stand there quietly while the next part of the test is done. In this part of the test, we measure your blood pressure and your pulse every minute. And we do this by just putting a pulse ox on you so we can see it. You know, the pulse ox on your finger just gives a constant readout. You could do it with any other device that monitors heart rate. And then someone who knows how to do a blood pressure measures the blood pressure. And look what happens to this woman when she stands up. So if you look at, let's just look at her, the top number in her blood pressure, which is called the systolic pressure. Starts out at 114, it kind of dips a little, and then it goes up, and then at about 6-7 minutes, it just starts going down, and at 10, it kind of hits 95, and she was really, really feeling ill by then. That's quite a drop in blood pressure. And if you look at her pulse, it started out at 75, and as soon as she stood up, it jumped close to 90, and then it gradually climbed up until it got to 100. But when she was 95 over 50 and her pulse was 100, she was about to pass out. She was feeling very ill. And when you can see her symptoms. She's just saying what she feels like at each point here. And as soon, you know, when she sat down, she just kind of burst into tears because she felt so horrible. This is a valuable test because the more I do this test, the more I can tell that there's abnormalities going on. The bigger problem, exactly how your blood pressure and pulse respond to this problem is variable. But the end result is you don't get great, vigorous blood flow out to all the places in your body, maybe most importantly, not to to your brain, because goes where gravity's going. And it's a little bit too long of a discussion to talk about the causes of this, but I want to tell you a little bit. So her systolic blood pressure dropped 19 points. Her diastolic pressure, that's the one on the bottom, dropped 28 points. And her heart rate went up 25 points. So this is a valuable test because it's an objective measure. You can match the symptoms and the physical signs. And signs means what you see. And I don't know if you can tell, but this woman's hands are very engorged with venous blood. Can you see that? It's hard to do a picture of things like that. But, you know, her hands got very puffy and her veins all stood out. This is a before and after. So when her feet are on the ground, they're sort of blue and puffy and the veins are bulging out. And then when we sat her back up on the bed, they turned to a normal color again. You see that? So this is what happens. There's some dysregulation of the way your blood flow gets around to where it's supposed to be going. This is a patient I saw who'd had very severe untreated orthostatic intolerance for years and could barely function. And you can just see it's changed the colors of her toes over time. Most people won't look as bad as that. So I want to tell you another story. This is a young guy who got sick when he was 17 in high school. And he was usual adolescent and didn't want to hear it from his mother or from me. And he was in and out of school. He was an athlete. I mean, he was, I think he ran track. He ran cross country. He was thin, healthy. And he came in to see me just before he went off to college. And he was like, yeah, you know. And he was so happy to get away from his mother and from us. I mean, you know, genuinely so. That's appropriate for someone who's ready to leave and go out on their own. But, you know, after the first semester, he became quite ill and he had to come back home. And he came into the office, and in the middle of the visit, I just thought, you know what? I got to convince this guy this is an important thing for him to address, because if I can't convince him, then he can't fix it. So I just stuck the pulse ox on his finger and I said, I want you to stand up right there. So across the desk from me, he stood up, and here's what happened. He started out, his pulse was 89. Actually, when they checked him in, it was 80. So I think I raised his pulse a little bit talking to him. But you can see he got symptoms right away. His heart rate, and I only did his heart rate, jumped up. And as long as it stayed up, it reproduced almost all of his symptoms. And I could see the recognition in his eyes. And I said, well, what are you feeling now? I mean, is this like something you've experienced before? And we got up all the way to the end, and when he said starting to shake, it was internally, right? He was just trembling, and his heart rate had gone up 40. I had him sit down, but the most profound thing to me is he couldn't talk to me for a few minutes. So I go, oh, this is great. Come over here. I'm going to show you what it means. And he was kind of like he was gathering himself, and he was trying to listen, but he couldn't listen. I couldn't hear me. And he said, well, look, just hold on. You know, he said, I need just a minute. I'm fine. And then he was faking it, right, until he kind of started feeling better. And he refused to go lay down on the bed. I mean, if you lay down on the bed and put your feet up, it's instantly resolved because the problem is blood going uphill. And he's just, no, I'm going to sit here and stand here. So anyway, but it was profound for him too. So we scheduled him to come back because what I didn't know is what his blood pressure was doing, right? You can see what his pulse is doing, but which drug we choose might be determined. So we had him come back, and he's doing a lot of things to compensate. He just didn't want to take any meds, right? He was drinking water and wearing compression socks. So we told him to stop those a little bit and come in for the test. And you can see that he did about the same thing with his pulse and the symptoms. And his systolic blood pressure dropped 20 points. His diastolic blood pressure was weird. It started at 61, dumped to 54, and then came back up to 89, which what we see often is the systolic and diastolic kind of go like this. As your body's, the vessels are compensating and trying to compensate from the change. So I was able to look at this, talk to him. And he didn't want to start a medicine, which is fine, but he is armed, right? We had a discussion about it, and he went out with renewed enthusiasm about how he could deal with this and what he could do about it. Just a couple more. I don't want to spend too much time on it. So this is a patient that honestly was mostly depression and pain, and no matter what we did, it never helped, and I thought she wasn't very motivated, and I was really kind of at my wit's end. Honestly, we tried everything, and one day I just looked at her and I thought, do you ever get dizzy? Well, she was actually talking to me about vertigo and said, all right, here's what we want you to do. I want you to come back. We'd run out of time. I just instructed her on medicines because she'd end up taking a lot of medicines for her mental health that actually were helping for orthostatic intolerance. We had her hold her meds, stop pushing all the fluids. We did her 10-minute stand test, and her blood pressure went down to 93 over 80. And actually, you know, that's a big dip. And her heart rate went from 85 up to 120, and it replicated all of her weird symptoms, these buzzing and tingling and a lot of the pain symptoms she was having. So my point here is that we could do better in the medical office, but even if we don't did in the medical office, you could do a test like this and you could take it into your doctor and say, help me know, or you can get online and read about it. But we will move along, and there's a lot of growing understanding about it. What you need to know is when you buy a personal monitor, try to get one that records heart rate. So you want the activity, the sleep, and the heart rate, so that you can learn about all those things. So one more I want to show you, because this one was one of the first ones that got my attention. And this is a young woman who is very ill from ME/CFS. She's got 2 to 4 hours of activity in her, this hours of upright activity in her daily. She's very productive. She does a lot of things. She isn't working. You can see her blood pressures when she came in. They're just like normal, right? 112 over 75 and a pulse of 77. So when she was lying down, blood pressure went down a little bit. Not sure exactly why, but you can see as soon as we started the test, she started getting symptoms. Look at her resting heart rate is 68. And it went up. Look at minute 6. It kind of peaked out at 132. That's a big jump in heart rate. And her blood pressure had tanked, and she's hanging in there, but it's kind of falling apart. Do you see that? When the pulse starts coming down, that's not a good sign, because the pulse is compensating for the blood pressure that and everything that's not working. And then we couldn't feel anything, and in the next minute, if they hadn't eased her down to the floor, she'd have been down and passed out just from standing in the office. So this is profound, because doctors don't ever do this. And so until we train physicians, as soon as people come in with these illnesses, to at least screen for this, and I don't know how many people have it, right? Because we're starting to measure it in our patients. I wish everybody with fibro and CFS and all these problems would start to understand, I mean, start to do some of these measurements. If you do it, don't wear your compression socks. Don't take any Adderall or caffeine. You know, be back to your natural self, that you're not doing all these things to try to compensate, and see what's going on. Now, this can also happen when people are ill or debilitated or never exercise. But I can tell you that it's way beyond that in most of these patients, because most of these patients are trying to stay active. And many of them actually have a pretty good level of activity, and they're compensating. So what do we do about orthostatic intolerance? This is a big umbrella. Well, you need to recognize and measure it, recognize it, and then learn what makes it worse. Learn what you can do to improve it. You know, compression, clothing, there are medications. You need to increase your volume. You need someone to help monitor you, because you might have high blood pressure or you might have some other problem. And there are quite a few things that can be done, and there's an increasing awareness in cardiologists. You know, some years ago, the cardiologist sent me all the patients with POTS or orthostatic intolerance. Now they're recognizing this, and of course, there's the neuroscience people up at the university that have brought us Dr. Cortez, who came and did the excellent talk. She's just bombed, right? Because she's the only one up there that does it. Her schedule is totally loaded, and it's not uncommon, these problems. So you want also to figure out how to get stronger muscles, especially in your legs, and do a little bit of cardiovascular so that you can keep that system from getting too relaxed. And then there's some things you can do to do a little better when you try to exercise. One of them is being in water. So if you're in water aerobics or you're swimming, you can do a lot more because it's like a pressure tank and it holds up your pressure. And these are some resources, especially you could watch Dr. Cortez's talk. So I'm not sure I want to talk too much longer, but I do want to say that pain as a symptom was left out of the core symptoms because it's variable, and not all patients have it. They may have it at certain phases and not others. And of course, fibromyalgia is characterized by pain. So people with fibromyalgia are defined by their pain, but people with ME/CFS don't always have pain. The good news is we have a lot of pain specialists. Pain is an area where medicine's much farther along. We know a lot about fibromyalgia. We have drugs. We have a lot more information. We have people who can do injections and all kinds of great imaging. So really, tool number four is get with good people who know how to take care of pain and sort through the different kinds of pain if you have them. And you don't need any special treatment. You can go to the regular people. And just a word about fibromyalgia, the case definition for fibro is pretty broad. You only have to have 3 months of kind of systemic widespread pain and tenderness to meet fibromyalgia criteria. So it's a useful description of that kind of pain, and it can happen in a lot of different circumstances and all by itself. So our understanding of that is getting better. And that kind of pain responds to those things we've been talking about, restorative sleep, and relaxing, and not too much activity, not too little, and other things. And there's really a lot of resources, including a lot of medications. And I'll just put in a word for low-dose naltrexone. Anyone with fibromyalgia should read about it. I'm not sure where it fits in people with ME/CFS. But in some patients with fibromyalgia, it's as good as any other approved drug we have for reducing that pain amplification. Not sure it will be true in everybody, but there are plenty of people who respond to it. And there are these are references. All you have to do is put LDN and fibromyalgia in Google, and you'll be able to find as much as you need. And this was just an old slide, kind of the strategies for treating fibromyalgia, which is, again, similar, right? Restorative sleep, bring down that pain amplification, work on emotional wellness as much as you can. I mean, that's a whole field that we have a lot of resources in medicine. And then the back leg of the table is, you know, to see if you can work your body back into a little bit more fitness, and it'll help you feel better. And try to pick drugs that do more than one thing. The last thing I wanted to reference is the last major required core symptom, and that is cognitive impairment. And this is also a big spectrum. There's lots of kind of brain fog in fibro, but the cognitive impairment that happens in people with ME/CFS is more severe, it causes more impairment. And this is an area we need to do more research in. The main studies show cognitive slowing. That means it takes longer for the signals to go where they're going. The IQ, the content is fine, so things that are timed are hard. Like if you have more time to accomplish something, you'll do better than if you're forced to do it in a short time. It also makes it difficult to multitask or, you know, carry on too many things at the same time. So the things that help it that we know now, pacing is probably one of the best things. You do your important work when you're more rested. Allow more time to do the same things. Use tools to help you remember things. And then anything you can do to sort of cut out all the other sensory input will help you, because those things are all tiring for your brain. So if that means, you know, getting in a quiet room or wearing earphones when you got to do important things. And same old, there are some medications, but to me they come at the end after all of the things are done, and sometimes you get a little extra help from medications for cognitive problems, and lots of medicines can make it worse. Okay, so I'm going to stop there and maybe take some questions, but the most important thing I'd like to leave with you is things are changing. it's also very important that we're not in Oz, right? We need to take all the people, all the science, everything back into mainstream medicine, get it going, train all of our physicians, trickle down, because we're going to be able to make a lot more progress doing that. And I do think we've got some great things at our fingertips, and we can all be assessing some of these symptoms for ourselves, and that information is going to be revealing to primary care physicians and the specialists that you need to go see. Okay, any questions? Yep, you can take it up to him.
Is it working? Okay. I'm just wondering if there's any correlation that you're aware of with Raynaud's and orthostatic intolerance, if those are like two different things or...
So Raynaud's is a spasm of the artery or the small artery. So it actually closes. And that means that the digit that's beyond the artery turns white from the spasm. And then it's kind of cold, and then, you know, kind of turns blue, and then eventually when the flow is resumed, it gets all purple or red. Sort of like when you've been outside, and your hands get really cold, and then you come back in, and they're like, swollen and red and sore. It's different because it's specific and segmental in Raynaud's. A lot of people don't really understand what Raynaud's is. If you can have constriction of the blood vessels and have, there's some terms for it in medicine, vasomotor instability or other things, the same thing that happens when your hands get cold. And that's a little different than Raynaud's. In orthostatic intolerance, what happens in many people is they don't have good vascular tone. So when they stand up, everything drops. And they don't get great venous return to the heart. Everything's trying to come uphill, but instead of having nice tone in their blood vessels, everything sort of sags. And then the body senses this problem. And if you don't put nice flow into the heart, it has a hard, you know, doesn't have a great cardiac output either. And you get this adrenaline rush, and it starts to make your heart beat faster. And there's also a signal to constrict the blood vessels out in the digits in your arms and legs, to preserve flow to the most important places. So lots of people with orthostatic intolerance have cold hands and cold feet all the time because it's all clamped down, trying to maintain perfusion so that it gets to the most important place, which is your brain, and also the muscles that are helping you stand up and not fall down. That's number one priority. So what I tell people is, you know, if you wait until you're dizzy or feel like you're going to faint, your body's been suffering for a long time already. That's when it gives up, right? That's when it can no longer compensate. So I think we need to, I'm trying to find a dynamic way to explain this to people because I don't think it's really commonly understood the more complex aspects of circulation of the blood, but the blood vessels out in the periphery are very dynamic. They can clamp down and open up, and it's true with everywhere, all the circulatory system, and it's also dependent on volume and how much sodium you have and a bunch of hormones that control it, and it's complicated. But the best analogy, I've been trying to figure out a good analogy, but if you can think about what it require for water to go up a big trunk of a tree. So there's the big trunk and then the major branches and smaller branches, and out at the tips are all the little teeny stems and the leaves. If there's a great water supply, the whole tree is great and green. If the water supply goes away, what happens is the tree dies back from the tips, right? And if, let's say even when cold weather comes, the leaves dry up, the leaves fall off, and the tree hunkers down, and the most important flow goes to the main places of the tree so the tree doesn't die. So your brain doesn't die, but it's hard to get oxygen delivery and glucose delivery out to all the active cells in all these peripheral areas if your blood pressure drops and if your heart rate can't compensate. And so lots of compensatory changes happen. I think there's some great research researchers who are starting to try to understand this better, but the nuances of how this is in all of the patients with this illness, I think, have just been, let's just say, not noticed yet, but it's starting to change. But wouldn't it be great if everybody did their own measurements? The thing to know, and this is important, is deconditioning can do this, some aspects of it, and so can medications. And it's one of the reasons why it's important to maintain as much fitness as you can, muscle tone and the things that you can do when you're ill. And it's also the reason to be careful about your medications. And when you take new medicines, you should see how they affect your sleep. You know, not only how they make you tired during the day, but do they give you more orthostatic intolerance? Or do they help? Because sometimes medications actually are inadvertently helping. Sorry, that was a long answer. Any other questions? Yes. Yes.
I'm just wondering if you're familiar with the ketogenic diet, either through calorie restriction and or exogenous ketones for managing like hypoglycemia and some of the other energy issues that a person might face. And if not, could you talk about nutrition maybe a little bit on what kind
I think
of
I'd like to maybe stay away because it's such a big subject. But ketogenic just means that you don't provide glucose in the diet. So your body has to break down fat and muscle to create glucose. And that's a whole nother field. But it brings me back actually to the fact that your cells, every cell in your body, but especially, you know, the two areas that are the most high burners of energy are your brain and your muscles. And they require constant supply of fresh oxygen and glucose because that's what's needed to do their job. And so, like the young man who stood in front of me and his blood pressure went down and his cerebral perfusion, the leaves stopped getting perfused, right? The gray matter didn't get it. The brainstem got it, and it kept him standing, but he was gone, right? He was just like, And then when we sat him down, it took him a while before his gray matter started working. That can't be a good thing for your brain. If that happens very long, like if someone has a cardiac arrest, they come back different, right? Sometimes they don't. So why would we want to intermittently underperfuse our brain? So I think it may help us understand more what some of the fatigue and cognition come from. And that's why it's really important to do more research and try to understand it. And I know that didn't seem related, but it did, because if you're a person who, let's say, have metabolic syndrome, you can lose weight and, you know, have more energy and lower your inflammation on a low carb and low sugar diet. But someone who doesn't have that, even people who do, that's why you feel tired when you first start doing it, because your brain is and muscles don't have ready glucose supply. Your body will provide it one way or another. So that's when people start to lose weight or they start to lose muscle mass, depending.
Do you think that because of the cognitive problems that fibromyalgia people have, that they have a bigger risk of early onset dementia or Alzheimer's?
I don't know, because so far no one's put much money into longitudinal studies. So, and also if you think about it, the term fibromyalgia was invented in 1990.
Right.
So we don't have, we're starting to have longer time, but, you know, it's really only been the last few years that people actually get diagnosed in large numbers. So first we have to make clear diagnoses, then we have to track people. And it also is important that we offer people the best care to help reduce the consequences. The CFS literature, the ME-CFS literature, suggests that people with illness develop all kinds of comorbidities and problems, and it may not be from the illness itself, but from what happens when you're unable to do things, or you have to sit too much, or you know, you're really unable to burn calories, and you know, the weight slowly comes on, or whatever, you know. So there are other issues.
So, you know, your center's full. What type of specialist would we be in the best hands with to, if we were to focus on one physician and educate them, what kind of specialist, what area would you recommend?
That's a good question. So just back to the center, right? It's not exactly that, well, we are kind of full, but it's because on any given week, we can see a few patients and 10 times that many people call. So that's why I feel overwhelmed, right? Because the need is so great. I would love to be able to help everybody. But right now there are a few people who are mad at me because I can't get my work done. And that's one of the reasons we limit how many people we can see, because if you just see everybody wildly, then they all start falling off the table. So it's really, I think, first about having a trusted primary care provider, whoever that is, nurse practitioner, PA, family practice, internal medicine. Honestly, it doesn't matter if they're caretaking and willing to learn and stick with you. And then in that first part of, you know, doing a differential diagnosis, that's whoever you need to see to make sure it's not something else. Until then, you know, you're the best to be educated and share that with your primary care physician. But I think every time someone sees a specialist, you should educate them about this illness. And things are great here in Utah compared to other places, because there's been an influence here. There are places where no one can get a diagnosis and no one is treated well when they go into the office. I had a friend in Michigan who I befriended and got to know online, who has the illness, and was trying to help her get into a primary care. And four times we struck out with someone, even if I called and sent the records and tried to pave the way, and they were just horrible. Finally, we took her back to her old primary care doctor. And this is my philosophy, is it's easier to train someone up than to go find someone new. They're just, younger doctors, actually, younger physicians are coming out a little more open-minded and less jaded by the old past. But I really think things will change fairly quickly as there's trickle down. And I believe the Institute of Medicine criteria are going to make a big difference because they came from a big academic institution. And the trickle down is slow, but believe me, it's trickle down and all of a sudden it's just gonna go whack into all the curricula and everything. And there's an effort at the CDC to provide physician education. So all of a sudden, doctors are gonna be expected to know about it and they're gonna be, you know, looking for resources. And they can learn it best from you.
I'm really sorry. Have you sent or worked with the University of Utah with their VO2 max testing? Have you sent any of your patients over there for that? As far as the heart rate monitoring and understanding
the cardiopulmonary exercise testing. I have in the past, I haven't recently. And it's interesting, right? And cardiopulmonary exercise testing is interesting because it's not done by physicians very much. It's done to study exercise physiology. I call it the Gatorade commercial, right? Where they're on the bike and they're, you know, assessing their gas intake and exhalation, and they're trying to get the most fitness, right? They're trying to understand all the things they can do to create the best fitness in athletes. And it's not used very much in medicine. The main use in medicine is there's a few studies that helped predict outcomes for heart transplant patients to decide who'd be the best candidate for heart transplant. It's not my area, but so you kind of have to go around, and at the university it's in pulmonary, but it's done by exercise physiologists in pulmonary. Funny story is I had one patient, young guy, all these problems, and I wanted to send him up for cardiopulmonary exercise testing. I called them up there. I said, look, this guy has chronic fatigue syndrome. I told them all about it, and I said, we're going to do this test. They did the test, and they said, holy cow, what's wrong with this person? We got to send him to someone, to a real doctor. So they referred him to a cardiologist, and the cardiologist said, ah, he's fine. But at peak exercise, his blood pressure only went up 10 points. He just couldn't mount a blood pressure. And his heart rate went up, but his blood pressure didn't go up. And then the person, the exercise physiologist was terrified because they've been, they know what to look at on that test. So again, it's moving kind of slowly. I like the fact that we have research using cardiopulmonary exercise testing in this field, but I don't think it ought to be used routinely in the clinic for anything because, unless someone can say to me, what do you get out of that other than proving to someone you have the illness? I think there are going to be a lot easier ways to prove the illness than we have people who are part of one of our research protocols who have not recovered completely from their exercise test that they did as part of research. Now, lots of people bounce back from a single test, but some people don't. So anyway, I'm not real enthusiastic about using it. I think once we understand the illness, protocols probably won't be approved by the IRB to put people on cardiopulmonary exercise tests. So remember that I said that, and we'll see if that's true someday.
As I navigate insurance plans, Medicare, all of the changes over a 30-year period with this diagnosis, I seem repeatedly to go with doctors who tell me three or four things that seem to be standard for people who are normal. Mm-hmm. And I'm looking at some of your graphs and statistics and looking at how very different things like heart rate or sleep is for people with these illnesses. Three things that are typically said are, you're obese, you don't exercise enough, and you must get a flu shot. after having some very bad experiences with flu shots, I finally figured out that was probably not my best way, but it's depressing because I know that against the norm, I am those things. And yet, every time I push those boundaries to lose that weight or exercise more, I cause a relapse. So my question to you is, are there reasonable, appropriate, good guideline tables for those of us who are abnormal?
I just gave them to you.
Is it just a matter of what you can do? Pacing? Pretty much.
Don't you know better than anyone?
Well, I do, but I feel stupid when my doctor says, you've got to increase this. You've got to do that.
Well, my polite and humble response is, don't feel stupid. You're the one who's right.
That's true.
So you just need to turn those tables. And it's not, we don't need to be mad at anybody. They're doing what they've been taught. But they need to have a frank conversation with people. And if you can't, you might need to get a new doctor. And I'll tell you, I fight the same thing trying to talk to doctors. But there are a growing number of very like-minded doctors. But there are still a lot of people who just don't want to hear it. And let me tell you a little bit about that person in Michigan that I was trying to help. So one of her doctors that we got her into as a new patient, I sent her a 10-minute stand test. I sent her data about her POTS. I was horrible. And I sent, a bunch of stuff because I'd been, helping her. And she went to her appointment, and the doctor drew blood and gave her a prescription for a mammogram and sent her home. And I'm like, whoa. So then we thought we'd try again. So I found an internist. That was a family practice doctor. I found an internist, and I sent all the records, and I did everything in advance. I really worked hard to pave the way. And she was in her visit and trying to talk to this doctor, and the doctor said, you could stop right there because I think you really need to be talking to a psychiatrist. I'm not kidding. That happened like a month ago. It's like, so the problem is that that's a devastating experience for people with this illness, and it's just not okay. I'm a little bit at a loss to know what to do. So with the most recent doctor appointment, when we sent her back to her old doctor, I did all those things and then arranged a call with the doctor. And when we started the call, I could tell this doctor was a very standard internist, and she didn't really buy in to everything we were trying to say, but if I get someone on the phone and they're really a doctor, I can have a conversation with them, right? Because that's what a good doctor is. They'll listen to what you have to say. You know, I'm gonna send her some papers, we'll work back and forth, you do your job. You know, I said, I'm so glad she's got a doctor who's knowledgeable, who will be there for her, and I think we're on board now. But there's still a little overlay, you know, of, eye rolling, here we go again, right? And it's because doctors don't know what to do, and they don't understand the illness. So we just need to give them a chance.
So I just have a question about pacing, actually, because that's probably what I'm working on mostly. So I have a physical therapist, and of course their idea for me is to add a minute every once in a while, you know, to increase my physical fitness. But it seems like I get to that 9 or 10 minutes, and no matter what, I can't really function past that without sitting down and resting for a while. Is that something, a ceiling I can break, like they're trying to encourage me to, or is that just my ceiling and I need to accept it? I guess that's my question.
You can't break ceilings.
Okay, that's just it then.
You might be able to gradually, or for some reason, you know, your ceiling and threshold might go up and down.
It does a little, yeah.
But I don't think you can actually break the threshold. I don't think you can move the threshold. You know, this is a hard one because I always have patients who, when they're forced to do more, sometimes it helps them and they have to do it and they don't have a choice.
Right.
But it's very difficult. But there are also people that they're just going to faint if you have them do it, right?
Okay.
And then who can calculate your post-exertional malaise and the cost of that but you? So this is really difficult. But it is the number one thing, and everybody should master it. But the thing about it is you got to get a thick shell, and you got to just say, here's what I'm going to do,
right?
And here's when I'm done. And you can't let other people somehow, you know.
Well, right, because they sent me to a pain psychologist at that point.
I mean, I have a patient who's a personal trainer, right. And she cries every night that she can't exercise with her clients. And she wears sweats and stuff so people can't see that she's not toned anymore. And, you know, she's had to cut back her hours. And, I mean, there's nothing she would like more than to get more fit. And she has to look at people every day and coach them, and she can't do more than she's doing.
Okay. Well, I'm an oncology clinical research nurse, actually, and I would love to help in your research if I could ever get feeling good enough. But so I was working at that. I got diagnosed with fibromyalgia. I probably have MS, though, I bet. also, looking at your criteria there. But I was in an auto accident in October, and I just have not been able to get over that. Can trauma intensify these diseases?
Yes. So, you know, I talk a lot about post-exertional malaise and coming outside the envelope. That's the part you have control over.
Right.
There are other things that can, you know, take you down a step. But you just have to do the best you can, right? And it may take longer. It may have harder consequences. And you just have to do the best you can for things that you have no control over.
Right.
But there are also things you might have control over, like decisions about procedures and decisions about things, if you have a choice. And my choice is, you know, least traumatic things. But there are also some things that can be done to prepare and ensure the most smooth recovery through planned surgery, for example, as opposed to a car accident, right, or a disaster that you just have to pick up the pieces afterwards.
Right, thanks. Appreciate it.
I want someone else to choose. Hold your hands up so that she can see where to bring the mic.
So what's the connection between what you've told us tonight and the biomarkers that you were talking about earlier?
Physical exam's a great biomarker. We just missed it all this time. I mean, it just takes a physical exam to diagnose orthostatic intolerance. And in my mind, that's an objective marker that we blew right over for a long time. Me too. Because I was traditionally trained, and even though I was be frustrated I couldn't get a tilt table test and all that stuff, and I'd kind of try the 3-minute test, I didn't do this, and now that I'm doing this, I know this is going to be really helpful, and everybody ought to do it, or something like it. And they've got all kinds of testing that can be done, but not everybody can access that now, that like Melissa Cortez, Dr. Cortez does up at the U. That's great, but what you need to know is this part of my clinical picture? And if so, what can I do about it? Because it's going to help you feel better if you can do some things about it. What's causing it is another question. And we're working our way down that, and we have some ideas.
So last year, the IOM report came out in April.
And February.
Was it February? And we were going through a review of our son's illness for SSI because he had been rejected. And so when we resubmitted the report to SSI, which is like a 5 or 6 page report, we basically had to answer almost all the questions in a different way than they were phrased in the thing, because it wasn't suitable to this whole thing about exerting yourself for any period of time. But also what we did is we attached 26 pages, which is kind of the introduction to the IOM report, to the submittal. And we submitted that, and he got approved without a lawyer or anything. So my question is, can you, if you're looking to educate a doctor, print off a 26-page report and hand it to him and say, could you please read this?
Oh, yeah, I recommend that people do that. So okay. there is a 20-page report or 20-something 26. Called the Physician's Guide.
Right.
And it's easy enough to print off. What I would do if I was a patient is I'd have the 300-page report on my computer, because you can download the whole electronic report. And if you're going to go to a cardiologist, just print out the pages on cardiovascular. You know, you can go to the sections on each of the major symptoms. There's a section on fatigue, a section on post-exertional malaise, a great section on sleep, a section on cognition, a section on orthostatic intolerance, and then there are more, neuroendocrine and, you know, others. So there weren't just the core criteria. So honestly, you could go to the index and see what matches that clinician, do the front page, and just print out those like 5-6 pages and take it to them and say, this is the most up-to-date evidence-based information that might relate, you know, it might be part of your specialty and relate to my illness. It's, you know, the report is called Beyond Myalgic Encephalomyelitis and Chronic Fatigue Syndrome, Beyond ME-CFS. And I've been able to find it easily on the web.
I think you can get to it through the Bateman Horne website, actually.
Oh, I bet that's true. Yeah. There's also, it's been published now. So actually, there's a published version of the report that you can look up in PubMed, too. So it's accessible on, the long report is accessible. You can download your own copy for free. You can also order the book, the bound copy, which isn't that much, and you can carry it around with you to your doctors. No doctor's going to read a 300-page thing, right? But if you open it, you know, circle that part and say, help me know how this might help you understand my illness. And then maybe, you know, the website, so they can go to the long report if they want to. I mean, this report isn't the end-all and be-all, but what it is it tells physicians that we know a lot more than they think. And it's a new foundation for moving forward. And it's very, very supportive of the illness, this ME-CFS report. If you haven't read, you know, the introduction or the summary or some of the beginning of that report, you should read it, because it'll help you feel validated and help you feel that things are going to change. You know, there is a fibromyalgia equivalent, and I wasn't part of that team, but the IOM also did a fibromyalgia project, and I'm not sure exactly we had a specific question to address, and that question was to use the research that's published to, you know, create a clinical diagnostic, create clinical diagnostic criteria, because it's a huge gap. Doctors don't know how to make the diagnosis. And there was all this confusion about what criteria to use. And that's why all fatigue and fibro and everything got lumped together. So the effort of this report was to take out people that have some of these things in common and look at them as a group. Doesn't mean they don't have pain or they don't meet fibromyalgia criteria. But if you meet these criteria, you don't just have fibro. If someone diagnosed you with fibro and you really meet all these criteria, you meet criteria for both. They're not really separate diseases, they're descriptions of symptoms. And we're not quite sure, you know, how to, that's why we need to move ahead with more science 30 years later.
So you had mentioned earlier that the exercise tolerance test is not the best way to prove that you have this.
No, let me go back.
Yeah.
It can prove that you have it, but it doesn't tell us what to do about it for you. And a single cardiopulmonary exercise test is not a guarantee, but there's a pretty good chance if you do the two tests in a row in good hands and show a decrement that that will be a good support. I just think it's a pretty high price to pay to show that you have the illness. And I'd certainly like to find some easier things.
where I'm at is that I was, 2 years ago, I was diagnosed after ruling out everything else and such. But of course, SSI and short-term and long-term disability, which I had paid for years, the premiums, they're pretty much saying, that's great, you got diagnosed, but prove it.
Right.
Are there other tests that are helpful for that?
Yes. If you did a 10-minute stand test and if you had abnormalities on it, that's actually written into Social Security recommendations for ME-CFS. It says tilt table testing or other equivalent clinical measurements. So I don't know what it'll show on there, right? But that is an objective test, which is why I was saying, you know, we kind of have a biomarker there for some people. So we need to start exploring it and understanding, you know, how that, you know, how many people have it and how it impacts people's ability to function, et cetera. But you can see the person who fainted from standing 6 minutes, they're not going to be a very good candidate for employment right now. Yeah, and they won't know what it is, but I think what we will do, what I'm hoping to do on our website is kind of put some resources on there that you could, you know, print one off and take it in to your primary care doctor. It's not that hard. It's just that for a doctor to believe you, I mean, they're going to be skeptical about this. Back to the Michigan doctor, the most recent doctor, I sent her a 10-minute stand test, and I said, and she said, well, I did orthostatics in the office. And I said, you did? And she said, yeah. And she said, well, it was only this and this. And I said, she told me two measurements. And I said, well, how long did you wait? And she, a minute? And she said, well, no, I went to five. But I think she was fudging, right? She just didn't do it, right? Even though that was the whole point. I've sent people to cardiologists and had them not four POTS in orthostatic intolerance and had them not do any vital signs. So go figure. It's too time consuming.
This consists of two questions. One from my wife would like to know about the drug Lyrica.
Okay.
Or do you use it or has it been used for the treatment of fibromyalgia?
Mm-hmm. Do you have a specific question about Lyrica?
One, I guess prolonged use of it deteriorates brain function.
My cousin,
mm-hmm.
and she's taken it for 8 years, but she said that she was just told that they're now starting to find side effects that are causing brain.
I'd have to go back, but when I heard that about gabapentin, actually, not about Lyrica, and I went back to the paper, and it was actually
not quite the same as got passed around, got a little amplified, and I can't remember now the details of it, but all drugs, you know, have issues. If you have concerns, you know, I think the important thing to do is to, you know, dig into the literature and see if you can find the real source. It's also important to compare what you'd be with the drug and what you'd be without the drug, sort of like that overnight, you know, the sleep study with CPAP and no CPAP. It's not compared to an ideal. And so you have to decide any drug should provide more benefit for you than if you're not using it. I mean, clear benefit in your function, not just your symptoms. It should enable you to be able to do better. And I also think there's a time and a place for meds. Sometimes I'm heavy on the meds when people need to be rescued. You know, they're highly symptomatic and barely able to function, and we might use a lot more meds, but as people kind of come back to life and get doing a little better, then you pull back and try to find, you know, what the most important ones and which ones are going to be in a small dose or lasting. So we, you know, we use Lyrica a lot. It's a drug. They're neither bad nor good. And, you know, you just know about them. And for some people, it's a miracle. And for some people, it's the worst thing they ever did. We actually did a study of people with fibromyalgia and chronic fatigue and put them on Lyrica and did gene expression. And their experience on the Lyrica matched their gene expression. So you could tell from gene expression who felt better on the drug and who felt horrible on the drug. So in a way, honestly, you could almost use that to predict who'd do well on it, but that's not going to happen, I don't think. Yeah, I actually whipped through a slide that had a whole bunch of treatments for fibro. We'll be posting this. So you, if you want to listen to it, you can go through it. You can stop, you know, you can, if you're watching on YouTube, you can pause it, you can read it, and we'll probably post the slides. There was a slide with a lot of stuff on it, but I sort of breezed through because I was going over time. We can only do so much in one night. Any questions about the tips and about things moving forward and about, you know, ideas for more self-management and teaching your primary care doctors?
On a different website I was looking at, it was talking about pacing by numbers, and that was why I asked one of the questions about one of the tests to identify your maximum, your... Yeah, your
anaerobic threshold.
Your anaerobic threshold. What's your opinion on the pacing by numbers? Do you feel like, you know, like...
I think it might be hold true for some, but not others. Here's the reason, and you'll notice this threaded into my talk, but I didn't emphasize it. Some people's heart rate goes up a lot just from standing up, which is a whole different process. So if you don't have that, and you're just trying to see how much exercise you're doing, understanding about where your anaerobic threshold is helpful. That's just one theory, though, that if you stay below your anaerobic threshold when you're doing things, it's be like understanding a number for understanding that threshold. I personally think you're better to just really start to trust yourself and experiment. The only risks are doing way too much and doing way too little. So you just need to practice. And you need to take into account not just exercise, but standing and other kinds of stressors. So if someone goes and does a very big, you know, intellectual or cognitive stress, sometimes they'll be just as tired as if they did a bunch of exercise. So you need to understand what those stressors are. You need to study about the illness. Actually, there's a lot in here. If you could go through and like read the slides carefully, because I packed a lot in there and then buzzed over it. What I'd like to do is we're going to try to put more informational videos on our website. It just takes time. And right now I'm booked all day, you know, seeing patients and not getting my write-ups done and not getting calls returned. So there are a couple people in this room that have been waiting for a call from me.
Just don't get mad at me for not calling you. Yeah, she gave up on me calling her back a long time ago.
I have seen so many doctors. I am one of those who got sick in 1985. So I've had a long time. So I've seen bunches of doctors. But I have finally found my primary care physician. I have been with her since 1996. Now, on all of my records, it says that I had mono, I had Epstein-Barr, I had chronic fatigue, I had fibromyalgia. Okay, but I saw her in 1996. It wasn't until after I saw about the time I was getting ready to see Dr. Bateman, and I told her, I said, I'm going to go see Dr. Bateman. I've decided that it's time for me to get a handle on some of this other stuff. And she says, well, so why? And so we started talking about, this went back to 1985. And she said, well, did I know that? And I said, well, it's on my records, but I said, it's before your time. And anyway, so we had a discussion, and it was eye-opening for her. And it had never occurred to me that she did not put two and two together. But she hadn't. But the other thing she told me, she said, okay, she said, and she kind of discouraged me somewhat. And I said, well, you know I'm going to do what I'm going to do. Mm-hmm. So, and here's why. And she said, okay, but here's what I have against doctors who just want to lump everything into fibromyalgia or chronic fatigue. They stop looking for comorbidities. They stop there. And then they just write you off. And I said, well, you know, I'm past that too. But the one thing she has taught me is that when you go to a new doctor, whether it's a specialist or a primary care physician, does not matter, do not go in there with 20 pages of complaints, because they'll stop you in the middle and they'll say, you need to see a psychiatrist or you need to see somebody else. But if you go in there and just say, you know what, I keep getting these sinus infections and I do not know why. And then they start to talk. And then you go, the next time you go, you know what, there's this other odd thing. What do you think? So if you take it two or three things at a time instead of 15, you'll get a lot further, a lot faster, and your stress level will go down. And I know, I know how it is to be so stressed that you go in and you want them to fix everything. And you know what? It's not going to be fixed. And at some point, we have to, as patients, we have to say, I will be the best that I can be, but I am not going to be fixed.
Yeah. Well, I think that's important because it's sort of like, go back, let's, you know, come back, circle back around to the Wizard of Oz, right? You can't expect your doctors to be the wizard. You can't go in and say, fix me, you know, fix me. So we need to do it the old-fashioned way, which is everybody tries to work together. That's why we need, you know, to pull it all together and get back into mainstream. And I'm going to do my very best to bridge that gap. Our nonprofits, that's our major mission, but we can all do it. And it is going to be a little frustrating. It's going to take some time, but it's one relationship at a time with clinicians.
I was just going to say, you were asking about future things. Do you think they ever will come up with a cure?
So her question is, do I think they'll ever come up with a cure? So I will just, I'll be very realistic and say, what does an MS person say about their life? Do they hold on and hold on until they find a doctor who can cure them, right? And really can't move on until there's a cure for their illness? No, because lots and lots of illnesses are incurable. They're chronic illnesses. Nobody wants a chronic illness. What we lack is validation. And when we have validation, and we're folded into the mainstream and offered normal, you know, professional care, that kind of a feeling will be less. I mean, everybody wants good tests and good treatments. We all want that. But hoping for a cure maybe is going to be an unrealistic view that's going to set us up for disappointment. Not to say some people don't get better.
All right, I think our time is up. Thank you so much for coming, and thanks to Dr. Bateman.
Yay, thank you, everybody. See my aura ring? If anybody wants to come look at my ring, you can.
And I just want to do one announcement. Thank you, Dr. Bateman, so much for that very insightful talk. It was excellent. Thank you so much. Our lunch and learn that we have monthly lunch and learns on the third Wednesdays of each month. So it'll be on August 17th, the location of Citrus Grill on 39th.